Now let's talk more about these lobes. These are just simply designated areas of each hemisphere. So what we have is mirror hemispheres, right? On one half we'll have one lobe, and on the other half we'll have a mirror lobe. The lobes will be the same on both sides, although their function will differ slightly based on which hemisphere they are located in. So we got lobes, four that you want to know for your test and four that are dominant. There's other areas, we'll talk about them. The occipital lobe, visual processing. That is in the back of the head. And a great way to remember that is occipital sounds like ocular, and ocular has to do with vision, right? Another way to remember it is cartoons. You ever seen somebody get hit in the back of the head on a cartoon? No? You're deprived. You hit them in the back of the head on a cartoon, and what happens on the cartoon?
Double vision.
They see stars, they have double vision, exactly. They start seeing things. You ever been hit back of the head, you see things. Why do you see things? Because the blow to the back of the head causes neurons to fire in your visual cortex randomly, which you then cannot make sense of until it calms down and restores to normal activity, which is processing information from the visual sense, right? So the occipital lobe in the back of the head, vision is what it's primarily associated with, although other things are represented there. It's far more complicated than just breaking it down to a few lobes. The parietal lobe is kind of across the top here. It's the sensation, somatosensory cortex, sense of touch is there. So for me to feel that pressure I keep talking about when I push one finger into this palm of this hand, I'm feeling pressure both on the end of the finger and on the palm of the hand because the afferent neurons, the sensory neurons, are sending signals, pressure reception, the energy that I'm creating is being read by those sensory neurons, transduced into an electrochemical impulse, which then travels to my spinal cord, up to my brain to be read as touch, right? The sensation of touch. And what you'll find in that area is that there are neurons that are proportional to the sensitivity of the area of the body that you're experiencing that sensation of touch upon. So what you'll find is there are lots and lots of neurons dedicated to the tongue. And if you think about that, what do babies do when they're real little? With anything you put in their hand, stick it right in their mouth. And they start really what? Exploring the object with their mouth. Their mouth has the most neurons devoted to it in terms of surface area proportionally than any other area. The fingers also have a lot, right? But on the back, not so much. If you take a compass, you know the little thing you'd make a circle with back in geometry class? If you took a two-point compass where you have two metal points, right, then you could detect a distance being two different points on the tongue of 1 millimeter. Right, just a fraction of a difference, and you can tell it's two different points. You can open it up almost to maybe a centimeter on the back before you can tell it's two different points. There are fewer sensory neurons in the back than there are in the tongue or the hands or the feet, right? Those areas are sensitive, and so they give us more information sensorially. So the parietal lobe being across the top, physical. So you can think of physical touch and P for parietal lobe. Temporal lobe, we've already talked about. In terms of language processing, it does other things, but for your test and for the general sense of what that thing does in the brain, it's processing languages. All right? So I can think about language as being something I hear. Of course, it's something I can see, which would be in the occipital lobe, and then relayed to other areas of the brain that would be dominant for language interpretation. But if I'm hearing it, I can think about music, and music has a tempo. Right, so a good mnemonic for temporal lobe is tempo. Tempo is something you hear the beat, you process it as music. You don't hear music as random noises. You hear it as ordered sound that you interpret, and sometimes passionately so, right? It means something to you because it's a form of symbolic language that we process. So think of the tempo and temporal lobe, and that will help you to remember that the temporal lobe deals with language processing. Well, of course, so does the frontal lobe. That's the largest area of the lobes relative to other species. We have more frontal lobe than monkey, than dolphin, than whale. Those are some higher organisms. They have fairly deep thoughts, theoretically, relatively speaking. But they don't respond to the environment like humans respond to the environment. They don't adapt to situations like humans adapt to situations. And they don't have complex societies the way that we have complex societies. Some of them have complex societies. Some of them do communicate in sophisticated ways, but nothing approaching what humans can do. Humans' ability to think abstractly, to engage in logical processes, not that everybody does it, but that they have the capacity to do it, right? To be able to interpret things, use symbols, and relate that to others, and engage in long-term planning based on abstract theories and hypotheses, that's unique to human beings. And it seems to be housed predominantly in the frontal lobe. And it also engages things like motor control. So as I said, if I want to walk across the stage, I'm not thinking walk across the stage, but it's happening in my frontal lobe. And if I want to say something, like with Broca's area, I need to engage my frontal lobe to move the muscles to cause the air to flow across the vocal cords and out the mouth in such a way that it can be recognized as speech. Make sense to everybody? So the frontal lobe is critical, and it seems to develop last, which may explain why some teenagers are so damn impulsive, especially males, because males develop a little bit more slowly than females. And you look at the behavior and maturity, maturation maturity, not necessarily moral maturity, other kind, maturation maturity, the older you get, the more these structures start to finalize, and we'll talk more about that in development, and you then get inhibition of impulse because you require the frontal lobe to inhibit impulses. And if you want to see it in action and to bring it back to a practical level, you watch somebody who drinks so much that they start acting a fool, what are they doing? They're inhibiting frontal lobe activity, which would normally have inhibited that foolish behavior, right? So they start acting wild and impulsive because the frontal lobe that would normally be active to prevent that behavior is now being put a little bit to sleep. It's a central nervous system depressant, right? Alcohol and other drugs, not necessarily alcohol, but you see what I'm saying? When you affect the brain, you affect the function. And I'll just show you a couple of pretty pictures. There's some mac and cheese. You got your hindbrain, your midbrain is up in there. Occipital lobe's in the back. Temporal lobe is where? Right here by the ear. That's easy to remember, right? Because that's processing your language, your tempo, hearing the music. Frontal lobe, well, that ought to be the easiest of all of them to remember because it's up front. So if you can remember that your frontal lobe is in the front, your temporal lobe is by your ear, you get hit in the back of the head, you see stars, because that's visual processing area, the visual cortex being in the occipital lobe, then what's left is on top, and that's the parietal lobe. Physical touch is one of the sensations you have up there. So P being there. There's a brain that we can look at more in depth, and what we see is the interior of one hemisphere. So theoretically, we're looking at the left hemisphere, which would be housing language. You can see the spinal cord is coming up through the base, through that little outlet in the skull in the back. You got your medulla oblongata, you got your pons, you got your cerebellum, you got your midbrain structures up here, and then this forebrain that we have, this cerebral area, the cerebellum, cerebral cortex is encompassing all the outer layer, right, and divided into two hemispheres, which are then connected by this little band right here. Oh, somebody's got a, look at this. Somebody left a pointer. Right here, across there, is your corpus callosum, which if you sever it, doesn't seem to do much, unless you do very funky research with people, in which case you'll see that there is a function to it, and it works in conjunction. So looking at this, we're going to talk, you remember we talked about the thalamus, right? There's that old thalamus. And there's your hypothalamus below the thalamus, and there's this pituitary gland, which we're going to talk about here shortly. Looking a little bit further, some things I've mentioned, but you don't need to know for your test. We got your premotor cortex up at the top, red representation right there is your primary motor cortex. In other words, to execute the movements that you have planned up here in your frontal lobe, you now need to transmit that information here, which then transmits it down through the spinal cord. All of this being the central nervous system, to move this arm outward, I have to now transfer that information to the peripheral nervous system, which dumps, right? What's the acetylcholine? Thank you. acetylcholine onto my muscles, and that allows me to move those muscle fibers in a coordinated fashion, right? When I feel the touch, then I'm getting an afferent neuron, sensory neuron traveling back into the spinal cord, back up to the brain, and then I go, wonder what that is touching me, which is some advanced thinking about what it is I'm perceiving, which is routed through the thalamus. So right down here, primary auditory cortex, right? There's your Wernicke's area for understanding language. This is all the temporal region. Here's your Broca's area for producing language. And there's that somatosensory cortex I was talking about that has the differentiation of numbers of neurons that represent various areas of sensation on the body physically. And then back here, you got your primary visceral cortex, which is part of your occipital lobe. Questions? Isn't that cool as shit? You don't find it that to be that case, man? All of this is what you do every day. Every single bit of it is what we do all day, every day, until what? It stops working. And then you die. That's it. Fascinating, isn't it? And then what happens after that is beyond our ability to determine scientifically.